Let me begin by introducing myself. I know many of you out here who've come out here tonight. I'm Mark Everett. I'm the President and Vice Chancellor of the University of the Fraser Valley. And I established the President's Leadership Lecture Series a couple of years ago to bring outstanding leaders to our region and to our communities, to educate and to inspire us. And tonight, I believe we're bringing a real treat. A man recognized for his six-decade leadership in popular music and culture, and a man who has found countless ways to use his talents for the betterment of others. Yeah, I know, 6 decades. He doesn't look that old. In fact, he's not. The explanation it is that he was spinning rock and roll records on a local Vancouver radio station while he was still in high school.
Thank you.
I've also just learned, though, that he and his wife, Carol, are about to celebrate their 50th wedding anniversary. And Carol is with us tonight, so perhaps, Carol, would you mind standing and let us recognize perhaps 50 years of sainthood? Well, in his career in radio and television, Red Robinson has met and interviewed many of the influential names in the entertainment business. We're going to hear a little bit about that tonight. And, of course, he's brought us in British Columbia and in Canada some of the very best. In 1957, he was the MC of the Elvis Presley show at Vancouver's Empire Stadium. From 1963 to 66, he hosted CBC-TV's Let's Go and introduced some of Canada's best-known rockers, including Randy Bachman, Terry Jacks, and The Collectors. In 1964, he welcomed the Beatles to Vancouver. We met one of our staff in the hall this afternoon, and this fellow was keen to shake Red's hand and to say to his colleague, "I just shook the man who shook Paul McCartney's hand." During Expo 86, he was a promoter of the Legends Rock and Roll Concert Series. And over the years, working for various radio and television stations, he worked with countless major popular recording stars and taped interviews with over 650 personalities. Red is still very active in the BC entertainment industry. He greets stars of yesterday and today as they perform at the Red Robinson Show Theatre in Coquitlam, and plays DJ Sunday afternoons on AM 650. Red is the author of Rockbound, A History of Rock and Roll in Canada, as well as a number of other books recording the cultural history of his musical instruments and of our communities. He's also been very active in the advertising business, forming two advertising agencies, very successful agencies in 1969 and 1987. Now that's a character I think we'd all like to see on Mad Men. Red has received many honors and been recognized internationally. In 1995, he was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in Cleveland, Ohio. The same year, he was inducted into the BC Entertainment Hall of Fame. In 1997, he was elected into the Canadian Association of Broadcasters Hall of Fame, and in 2000, elected to the Rockabilly Hall of Fame in Memphis, Tennessee. And, of course, the 1,100-seat Red Robinson Show Theatre in Coquitlam was named in his honour. But that's not all. He's been a model of commitment to service to others, bringing his skills and passions to a number of important causes. From 1976 to 2000, he served as the main host of CBC-TV's Timmy's Christmas Telethon. Both Red and his wife Carol are dedicated supporters of the Child Foundation, with Red emceeing many fundraising events. Child stands for children with intestinal and liver disorders, and Red also serves on the board of directors of that foundation. He's also found numerous ways to support the Heart and Stroke Foundation and many other charities. For all of these things, his pioneering and his leadership contributions to the Canadian music industry, and for his philanthropic work, the University of the Fraser Valley awarded Red an honorary Doctorate of Letters last spring. And welcome back, Dr. Robinson.
Thank you.
Our format will be an interview with Aaron Levy, University of the Fraser Valley's civil radio station manager. Yes, for those of you who didn't know, we do have a student-run radio station, and I would urge you all to tune in. Aaron has been the manager of civil radio since 2010, and there are very few campus events where I don't see Aaron. Many of you may recognize his voice as the commentator of the University of the Fraser Valley basketball games. Aaron was raised in Toronto, and I understand he's quick to apologize for that, but I was raised in Toronto, so I'll be right behind you there apologizing, Aaron. He holds a Bachelor of Arts from the University of Guelph, where he majored in philosophy, and in the spirit of UFV, blending the philosophic with the practical, he also attended Conestoga College for training in radio broadcasting. He also trained at York University's CHRY station, 105.5 in 2003, volunteered as a DJ and board member at Guelph's CFRE 93.3 FM station, and served as the voice of the Guelph Griffins at their basketball games. He, too, has had quite a varied musical experience interviewing rappers such as K-Non and 50 Cent, classic punkers John Cale of the Velvet Underground and Klaus Fluoride of the Dead Kennedys, and contemporary Canadian artists like Mother Mother, Sloan, Winter Sleep, and both Kenny and Spenny, I understand. Well, tonight he's going to be interviewing Red Robinson. Before I begin, I want to express my sincere appreciation to Michelle Favreau and the Mission Chamber of Commerce, who are co-hosting this event with us. And I hope you will, at the end of tonight's event, join us out in the lobby for some refreshments. Those refreshments are courtesy of Save-On Foods and Grab a Java, both well-known to those of you from Mission. I'll stop talking. I'm going to turn it over to Aaron and Red. Over to you, folk. Welcome, Dr. Robinson, and thank you, Aaron.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you. Thank you, Mark. Dr. Everett's been a great supporter of civil radio, and I'm really appreciative to have the opportunity to speak with you, Mr. Robinson. Dr. Robinson, I should say.
Yeah, what's up, Doc?
I don't eat carrots. I'm sorry. I apologize.
You know, it's a funny thing. He mentioned, I'm getting older. No kidding. But I just had my birthday, and my little grandson said, what's it like to be this old, Grandpa? And I said, well, the one thing I noticed, Aiden, is that the candles now cost more than the cake.
And easier to blow out now?
He got
more
that.
More practice?
He got that.
Red, Canadians will know you as one of the first DJs, one of the first jocks, as we call them in the industry, to play rock and roll on a regular basis on the radio, starting in Vancouver. For a 16-year-old today, we were talking before we came up on stage, for a 16-year-old to get the opportunity, specifically in the commercial broadcast industry, at CIVL we have high school students who volunteer their time and they receive training. Back in 1954, to be a 16-year-old on commercial radio with the opportunity, not even to make that difference, but just the opportunity to have the microphone, to have that soapbox. How did you get that opportunity? Where did that come from?
Radio was going through a transition period. They went from the old radio shows, which most of them turned up on television. I Love Lucy, Dragnet, Gunsmoke, all went from radio. And they had all this open time. So it was really around the era of the birth of the disc jockey. And there was an afternoon teen show in Vancouver called Theme for Teens. And it was conducted, hosted by a man called Al Jordan. So here I'm a kid, and I listen to the show, and I listen to another DJ called Jack Cullen at night. And I thought, well, what if I phone that afternoon teen show? Because I looked at the Vancouver Sun, and there was a picture of actor Jimmy Stewart, who was in town. He was on his way to make a movie called The Far Country in Alberta. So I thought, okay. So I picked the phone up, and I phoned. I said, oh, hi, is this Al Jordan? This is Jimmy Stewart. He believed it. And I even put a nice plug in. Oh, coming up is a Glenn Miller story. He said, well, thank you. And the next day, a columnist in the Vancouver Sun, Jack Wasserman, wrote, "Wasn't that nice of actor Jimmy Stewart to call a kid's show?" So I thought, oh boy, I'm in trouble. But that's how, and a few days later, I worked up my courage again, and I called in as a character from the movie Casablanca, Peter Lorre.
I said, Al, I love your show, and I'm sitting here listening with my old flame.
Anyway, he said, "Just a minute. Are you the guy that phoned in as Jimmy Stewart?" So he said, "Come on down." To make a long story even longer, no, to make it shorter, I went down, and Al used to broadcast out of a little studio that held 100 people across from the Grosvenor Hotel. And I went down there and started, you know, appearing on the show, writing little humorous skits. And Al left and went to Hamilton, Ontario. And the program director said, "Listen, we're going to put you on the air and we'll try you out." And so literally I auditioned live on the air. And I went on and I played, and by then there was a whole hour. I played a whole hour of rock and roll, and I came out, and Vic Waters and the on-air people were all there. And of course, I'm a kid, right? And they're all applauding. I'm saying, "What's going on?" They said, "You won." I said, what did I do? And they said, "Look at the switchboard." It was just a Christmas tree. And so that's how I started, you know, with no experience. You couldn't do that today, and not in the major market. That's what different about the story. But then I started playing rhythm and blues and rock and roll that they didn't have. But there was a little juke joint up on West Broadway called the Oakway, and the guy would give me the records out of the jukebox. I'm talking about Ruth Brown and Lloyd Price and people like that from R&B, and I played on the air. And it took off, and everybody was saying, "What is this?" Ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you, I never knew that this show was taking off until it got so bad, all the kids trying to get after school into our theater that held 100, they were lined up for five blocks. So the police department talked to the program director and said, "He can't do that anymore." So I said, "Well, why don't we do the show live from the Kitsilano Showboat?" It was an amphitheater, it's still there, Kitsilano Beach in Vancouver. So I promoted it for 5 days, and when I showed up down there, 10,000 kids showed up. 10,000. I have photos of that. And I knew that I was on the right track with rock and roll.
So you had a lot of experience with the crowds before.
Exactly.
And that's very different than how we broadcast today, for the most part, that you have your live audience there of thousands of people. Even when you do a live performance, I mean, it's not day after day, show after show of however many 100 people. You maybe have two people in the studio who are working with you.
Well, radio went through a whole bunch of changes, but at that particular junction, I loved it. And I was talking to you about it on the air today. What we did was we play music and asked them what they thought of it. Amazing, isn't it? You ask the audience what they want to hear, and it worked. And that's what converted radio. And it was the youth generation exploding at the same time. I really believe, when you look back, that rock and roll, like it or hate it, saved the music, the movie industry and the music industry and the radio. Why? Because there was this new invention called television. And people at a certain age would sit home and watch TV. But youth, full of energy, did not. And so when a movie came out called Blackboard Jungle, and I went to see the opening, and I'd already been on the air for a year, everybody got up in the aisles and started dancing to Bill Haley's Rock Around the Clock. That changed everything. That became the national anthem of rock and roll. So that was the beginning of it all, Aaron. Just a kid going to school, you know. Never looking for money. There was none. As you know, there's none today.
Yeah, unfortunately. And it's interesting that you say asking the audience to make those choices. That's exactly what gave you your opportunity, you being the audience, getting the opportunity to make those choices. What we call citizen journalism today,
right,
is basically a model that we didn't realize was, or I didn't realize, and many of us probably don't, was developed long, long ago.
What I told the young people in the studio today, you can succeed at anything if you have a passion, a love for what you do. If a guy's a plumber, love it. Go to work every day and be a good plumber. And you know what I said, Mark, one time. I'm always speaking out of turn. I said, even professors need plumbers. You know what I'm saying? So, no, but as a society, Mark was agreeing with me. We spent too much time on have a university degree. And yes, it's important for a lot of things. But there's a lot of times when people are not cut out for that. So why do we put them down for being good plumbers, good electricians, good carpenters? And I see a change in society now going that way.
I would say, Red, probably especially professors need plumbers.
Okay.
A lot of no comments for 50 Cent as well, Red.
One for Aaron, zero for Red. Go ahead.
So, Red, you've developed into this icon of British Columbian and Canadian entertainment. You're born and bred. Where are your roots here in British Columbia?
I was born in Comox on Vancouver Island. And my mom and dad were both born in Nanaimo, you know. And my grandfather was the first railroad engineer on Vancouver Island. And the little train he worked on was a work train they brought up from Panama to build the ENN, as we call it now. And he was the first engineer. That little train sits out at Heritage Park in Burnaby to this day. And it's kind of a thrill for my family to go out and look at it. But that was it. Then my folks moved here during the war, World War II. No. Not the Civil War. You know what I'm saying? Because it was, the president here, Mark, said to me, how long have you been in radio? I said, well, let's put it this way. I knew Marconi. But if you don't know who Marconi is, I'm in trouble. But
I know Fessenden.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. He's got an Italian restaurant in downtown Mission.
That's Bozzini's. Oh, no, that's in Chilliwack, sorry.
But it's been a great ride, but it's just back to the, if you're dedicated to something and you love it, it's going to happen. What I want to do here, Aaron, is walk through my journey very quickly and succinctly. We live in an age of narrowing attention spans. I learned it from my own theater. Acts today that come to the theater they named after me. 90-minute shows, that's about it. It's interesting. So we're going to do that here in what I call a clip series. But I did want to mention a couple of thrills that I've had in the years. One of them is there was a comic. How many of you remember a comic, incredibly wonderful a comic called Jonathan Winters? Anybody? Thank you. Jonathan, you got a picture of him there. But Jonathan came to Vancouver, and there he is. We cut 52 national television commercials for the Hudson's Bay Company. He was a treat and a delight. And he collects native art. So we spent a lot of time searching that out. But a wonderful man. He was in Mad World. He was also in Mork and Mindy. And he was the inspiration, as he tells the story, Robin Williams. Robin Williams' inspiration. That was a goodie.
So can we go to a clip right now, Red?
Pardon?
Can we go to a clip right now of Jonathan Winters and yourself?
Sure.
So mark track 7, please, if you don't mind.
Hello, sport fans. We wonder if we're on the air. There's one way of finding out, and that is, of course, enunciating clearly, talking like an announcer, and giving very profound statements, such as this. Do you read me?
The thing about Winters is, the old Tonight Show with Johnny Carson, who was the best, and Jack Parr, he would appear on there, and they'd have a table full of hats, and they'd throw a hat at him, and he'd do a whole routine. He was an amazing, amazing man.
Next up.
Chuck Berry. This photo here was a man out of New York who ran Madison Square Garden shows. And we brought Chuck Berry in, and he was amazing, but a strange guy because he's moody, a very moody guy. And I was warned that he would come on and say, I'm not going to play tonight unless I get an extra $5,000. So he tried that on me, and I said, you're not getting $5,000, and you made a mistake. He'd walked out in the Coliseum where everybody was there and tuned up. I said, if you're not going to play, they saw you. They know I brought you, so whatever. So all the other acts, with Bobby Curtola, the Chiffons, Freddie Cannon, all said, hey, we'll go on. So he went out and played Johnny B. Good. Great performer, but like Jerry Lee Lewis, who knows where their heads are at? I don't.
Do you have a favorite Chuck Berry song?
Yeah, I think for me, Maybelline, All About the Car. It was originally called Red Rooster. And then somebody said, what? You know, and so he changed it to Maybelline. I guess because he used a lot of eye makeup. No, I don't know. I don't know that.
Do you know what Chuck Berry's favorite song is?
No.
I was told during that liberal arts education I received. Well, if you had to wager a guess, you'd think maybe Johnny B. Goode, Maybelline, one of these classic
tunes. My Ding-a-ling.
Absolutely, 100%. My Ding-a-ling, the song that made him the most money in royalties overall, Chuck Berry.
Imagine being... Well, I can see that. Yeah, he can brag all he wants.
More from Chuck Berry?
Let's do it.
Oh, actually, let's hear a clip from Chuck Berry, track 8, please.
Do you think that this music for 1956 and 57, the music I call a big beat, do you think it's here for a few more months or a few more years? Or what do you think, Chuck? Yeah, I'm putting you on the spot.
No, it's been here, really. It's here for a long while. It's here as long as music will be here. That's rhythm and soul put together. This big beat that you speak of, it isn't new. It's new to a lot of people, believe me. But it's not new.
So, Rhett, for a moody guy like that, how do you psych yourself up to get a good response from an artist like that?
You start a conversation and turn on your tape recorder in those days. But he had been a hairdresser in the States, and that's what he was talking about. I said, would you go back, the hairdressing? And of course, he never did. Of course, why would he? Next up is a guy that many of us remember from Ozzie and Harriet. Remember that TV show? Rick Nelson. And it's interesting because Rick's band later became Elvis's band, James Burton and all the people that backed up Rick. But he came to Vancouver in 1958, and he played at the Forum in those days. And he would pause every once in a while. Now, you think nothing of it today, to go and get a glass of water, if it's throat or whatever. And the people booed him. The young kids booed him. And he couldn't get over that. Because it wasn't a dynamic show like Presley puts on, or Chuck Berry, or any of them. He'd stand and play. But he was a good guy. I had an interview with him where I asked him, do you ever look at your place in the music business and the fact that, he had become an icon? Here's what he said.
To me, and I don't know if anyone has ever put it in this light, you were one of the most significant people in the world of music for this reason. When I look back over your history of music, you did a lot for the black man by honoring people like Chuck Berry, Fats Domino, Baker Knight in your music. And I think the significance of Rick Nelson as history unfolds is that in those early days, you and a man called Elvis Presley had more to do with rock than anyone else.
Oh, well, thank you very much for putting me in that category. I was very fortunate in being around during that time period, and I think what happened is I probably filled a sort of an age gap there, because Elvis is just he's a little bit older than I am.
Yeah.
So I think that he had his fans in that category, and then with the television show and both of those things kind of working for each other, it kind of came together.
MTV gave him an award for creating the first video, because at the end of the Ozzie and Harriet show, he'd sing a song. On one of them, they had video things while he sang Traveling Man. So he got an MTV award for that. Very nice guy. Sadly, 1985, New Year's, was on his way in the South in his own plane, and it burned and crashed. And the reason I know all of that and why I can remember the date is because when I booked all the acts for Expo 86, he was on the list. And, of course, never made it. Yeah.
And that's not the first example we'll have of a tragic figure with a long legacy. And we'll see some more of that shortly.
Right. Okay. He calls himself the architect of rock and roll. Little Richard, a flamboyant entertainer. And this photo that you're looking at on the screen up here was taken in the studios of CKWX. How times have changed. They all have gatekeepers now. But in my time, in these great early times of rock and roll, we were all friends. And they'd come into the studio, you'd go visit them, and it was totally a personal experience. And he came into the station, and here are some of the things we talked about.
Well, I hear you're retiring from the music industry. Could you tell us why?
Well, because, when I came to show business, I used to play organ for the church when I was 14, 7, long years ago. And I always wanted to be an evangelist. And so I listened to Billy Graham, and I love his work. I think it's wonderful. And so I just want to do something for the Lord. I think it'd be better anyway.
Mm-hmm. Did you see Billy Graham when he was in New York?
Oh, yes, I've seen him a million times. Mm-hmm. He's wonderful.
So you are, in a way, tired of this business called show business, aren't you?
Yes, I have nothing against it. I mean, it's wonderful. I enjoy meeting all the teenagers and all the older peoples, too. But it's just the inward feeling that I have that I want to do something for the Lord, you know, because I just feel that the time is near. I feel that all of us are supposed to do something for him because he's been good to all of us.
Interesting. And he did quit the business for quite a few years. And you had to respect that. But it's amazing when I look back how they trusted me with these interviews. And I held on to them. Just a sidebar here, Aaron, and for the audience. When I went and was inducted in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame with a bunch of other pioneers, we were the early guys, I found out from people like Bruce Morrow and others that they never kept anything. A few of them kept a few things. Dick Biondi kept a few things, the Chicago DJ, who's a friend of mine, still around. But they didn't keep anything. And everybody said to me, well, you must have had foresight or vision. Oh, I'd love to say that was true, but it wasn't. I was a fan then, I'm a fan now, and that's why I kept everything. And just recently, ladies and gentlemen, I turned the entire collection, and it's now up to 1,200 interviews, over to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And, yeah.
Yeah. And you, Mark mentioned you were inducted in 1995. That was actually the inaugural class. You were one of the first group to be...
Well, yeah, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame started in 1986. And oddly enough, the first guy they put in there was Jerry Lee Lewis. Yeah. He said, I was inducted. Funny guy. Anyway.
Moving on.
I tried to put up people here on this particular event that a lot of various people will understand, even if you're younger. And this is one guy that everybody recognized because of a movie. It's Johnny Cash. Because of a movie called Walk the Line. And I want to tell you, this picture here of John showing me how to string a guitar, he'd bust a string, is taken backstage at a place called the Division Street Corral in Portland, Oregon. I went down there to get television experience because unless you worked for CBC at that time, there was no global, there was nothing. And so I went down there. But it was everything's an experience in life. And this was one of the best. From 1959 until about 5 years before he died, I would see John at least every 2 years. Quick story about this area. My wife Carol reminded me. I used to bring acts out here in the valley. One of my favorites and a great friend, and you'll see him in a few moments, was Roy Orbison. And I brought Roy and his band, which included at the time Bobby Goldsboro, another singer, and a rockabilly artist called Bob Lumen. Bob ended up marrying a secretary from CFUN when I was program director, Barb Tisman, and she lived in Chilliwack. Anyway, we put a show on there, and Roy's on playing. This is the second show, because we'd do two shows. Anyway, it was close to midnight, and my wife Carol came to me and said, there's somebody loitering around the dressing room, and he's got his foot, you know, one on the ground and the other against the wall. I said, I'll go down and have a look. I go down. It's Johnny Cash. I said, John, what are you doing here? He said, Red, I finished my act at the Queenie, wanted to come out and see my old friend Roy. So, you know, we used to bring them out here a lot, and Johnny Cash was an exceptional guy. What a wonderful life experience. And if you haven't seen Walk the Line, it is an accurate portrayal of Johnny Cash's life.
It's hard to... It's
even the bad part.
Yeah, a very visceral film and a lot of very deep emotional
but it's true.
Images.
He was alive while they were making that and watched it being done. The next artist... do we have some?
We do. We should have a Johnny Cash clip
as well.
Have
a Johnny
One album that you brought out that didn't get the attention I thought it should deserve along these lines... And it must have been an emotional experience when you and Carl and Roy and Jerry Lee went in and did the Class of 55. I treasure that album because it had a lot of magic moments in it, too.
Yeah, it really did. I enjoyed doing that. That was, you know, that was a going home kind of an album. And Carl and Jerry and Roy and I really loved doing that album. Although, as you say, it wasn't all that big of an album, but I think it was an important album. It's like 30 years later, here we are back doing what we do and feeling better about it than ever.
Great guy. And by the way, it's an album, if you ever get a chance, it wasn't a giant seller, featuring all the people he named there, Roy Orbison, Carl Perkins, and everybody. And it's called The Class of 55.
giants, literally giants of
yeah,
rock and roll.
The giants of rock and roll. The guys that started it all down in Memphis.
And in many ways, I mean, you look at Carl Perkins, some overlooked figures who really, maybe they got their due and maybe they could have got more.
But I'll tell you the loyalty of a guy like Johnny Cash. When Carl Perkins was on Hard Times, he put him in his group and took him on the road with him. Put him on his television show. They help each other. And that means a lot, I think. I think Canadians appreciate that more than most.
So is that helping one another? Is that part of why you were involved in bringing acts? I mean, it's not more than just hosting a radio show and spinning records. It's getting involved in the community and bringing those artists
That's
to the
right.
ground floor.
That's right. And meeting them, what a treat. You know, these are great memories for me, just to have met all these people and talk with them. I want to go now to my time at KGW in Portland, Oregon. And it was 1959. It was the Oregon Centennial Exposition. It was 100 years of the Conestoga wagons coming west to Portland. So there was an exposition. And one of the guys that appeared there as a guest on my radio show was called Bobby Darin. I don't know if you've seen the movie Beyond the Sea, but Kevin Spacey did an incredible job of being Bobby Darin. But you see how young we all are. Somebody in my office the other day said to me, Red, how did you get to meet all these people? And I said, there were no gatekeepers in those days. What gatekeepers are? Stay away from Shania Twain. She doesn't want to be infected with whatever you have. I said, I don't have anything. But anyway, Bobby would come out and do the show, and we would do some shows around the Portland area with him. A dynamic guy, an updated story on him. When Kevin Spacey was doing the movie Beyond the Sea, the Bobby Darin story, Carol and I were with two friends at High's Restaurant in downtown Vancouver. And Carol looked over and said, I think that's Kevin Spacey in the corner. And I said, oh, okay. So I'm not going to go over and interrupt them at dinner. It's not the Canadian way to do things.
It's the kind of thing I would do.
Didn't want to bother him, but I said to the waiter, would you mind taking a note to that man over there with a baseball cap on? And the next thing I know, he's standing in front of the table. What I put on the napkin was, Kevin, did you get a disc of Bobby Darin on my radio show passed on to you by Michael Bublé? Because Michael was playing the Blue Note in New York at the time. And so he's standing there, and he says, Red, I just want to tell you, I did. I got the disc. It was amazing to hear Bobby Darin doing your radio show. And number two, isn't Michael Bublé incredible? And I said, absolutely. So here's a bit of Bobby.
This is track two.
You listen to KGW, in case you're wondering who this strange voice belongs to. It's Bobby Darin of Atco Records. We're in town to do a few shows here around the Portland area.
Where?
Well, we're going to be in Longview this evening, Red, and that's about 50 miles from here, somebody said. But what was I going to say? Oh, the phone is ringing. We're not going to answer right this. Oh, is that the phone? That's the light to tell me to get out of the business, right?
No, that's the light that says we've both been fired. No, actually, that's the volume.
Oh, the volume. I see. Okay. Am I speaking loud enough?
Everybody hear him?
I just want to say something. We had 45 people standing outside, a lot of young people, and we just played Ray Charles' record, and the only one clapping and moving with the spirit was a woman who was maybe a little older than the group, maybe about 50 or so.
39.
39 she was. Thank you, Jack Benny.
Hey, thank you, Jack Benny.
Bobby was an incredible performer. My friend I mentioned earlier, we had an ad agency for years, and we were in Las Vegas, and I said, look, you got to come and see Bobby Darin. You won't believe it. I don't want to see Bobby Darin. He couldn't believe. This guy played about five instruments. He did impersonations. He danced. He sang. And he was the first one, as my wife Carol pointed out, that we'd ever seen that used screens in one of the big Vegas venues. He was an inventive guy and very creative.
Before Celine Dion and Michael Jackson and Kanye West and...
Oh, yeah, before all that happened. Yeah, this guy was a real innovator. One of my biggest thrills in my career was emceeing Elvis' show at Empire Stadium in 1957. And there the two of us are with a teddy bear. Let me explain the teddy bear, okay? His fans, local fans, saved their money up and brought him this big panda bear, gave it to me. Would you present this to Elvis, right? And I said, okay. So I did. We presented it on television and in front of the press. But when Elvis and I are alone backstage waiting 45 minutes to an hour, I think it was about that long, before we went on, there's just two of us in a dressing room. And he says, Red, you know this panda bear? And I said, yeah. He said, grown men don't collect teddy bears. He said, why don't you thank the fans for me and take it? That sits in my office today, that panda bear. We did a show at the PNE, Elvis Night. We did every year for 6 years. And we brought that out on stage. And my friend Phil over here will remember. It went viral. Everybody tried to buy it. People offered up to $30,000 for that bear. It stays here.
You should get more than that. $30,000?
Oh, yeah.
I'm not making it up.
You can put some good ranch together with that kind of money.
But here's Elvis at Empire, 1957.
Well, we're firing questions right and left here. Let me fire one at you. If everything folded up tomorrow, which it isn't going to by looks of things, what would you do? What would you do?
Go back to driving a truck.
You like driving a truck?
No, I don't know what I would do. That's counting your chickens before they hatch. I'd like to learn a lot about acting.
Who's your favorite actor on the screen, Elvis?
I have quite a few.
How about James Dean? Did you like him?
Yes.
You really did.
And Yul Brynner and Marlon Brando and, well, quite a few of them.
What do you think of TV? I mean, compared to the movies, you worked in both of them. What do you think of TV? I mean, not that you're slimy.
I like movies better than I do TV work.
Because you've got more time to do things right?
If you goof on movies, you can just go back and take it over. In TV, you just goof.
He was a good guy, and I don't say that other than the fact that he was just like a guy I'd gone to school with. And I told Mark earlier, you're saying, what was he like? I said, he had no conceit, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, he had vanity. He cared about how he looked, but no conceit. He was just a guy that had the same thing, had gone through the same life experiences I had, and I really enjoyed him. I think later on in life, he'd had a bad time. He started taking his good friend, Joe Esposito, who's become my friend in the last 10 years. He comes to visit me here. I go visit him there. And he told me that it started in the Army. On duty there when he was in Germany, he started taking these wake-up pills, and it progressed. And as tragedies happened with his mother dying, Priscilla leaving him, and all of that, he got worse and worse, and nobody could tell him to stop. People tried. There was no way.
And, I mean, we talk about Ricky Nelson and what we will talk about Buddy Holly and the tragic losses in the entertainment industry, the radio industry. There's also, beyond the tragic losses of, you know, acts of God and things like that, I mean, the substance issue is throughout the entertainment industry always something that is pervasive, unfortunately.
And I'm afraid that our Canadian guy, Justin Bieber, it's the way it's looking to me, he's going through this.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Well, Paul Anka has got a new book out, ladies and gentlemen. It's not on the market yet. It's called My Way. And get it, because he gave some advice in there to Justin. Don't take all of this seriously. It doesn't last forever.
Mm.
It's true.
And for someone as young as him. Red, I want to ask if somebody like Elvis saying, you know, I'd like to be an actor. You have the experience in television and radio. What would you be doing if you weren't in broadcast?
Other than broadcast? Well, no, I started an ad agency. I ran that with my partner for 15 years. It's an energy level. I have it. You're born with it or you're not. I would have done that. I would have done commercial art. And when I was in high school, my whole thing was I wanted to be a pilot. And I was an air cadet and got all the way to navigation. And then the radio came along. And I said, okay, I got my path, finally. But it's interesting. I was telling Mark, one of the things that young people don't get today is aptitude tests. Because an aptitude test isn't an IQ test. It's who am I? It tells you who you are. And I went and I got artistic creative on the marks off the board. But it also told me I'm a mechanical moron. Couldn't fix anything. But at least it led me down the right path.
So professors and radio jocks both need plumbers.
Yep.
I definitely do. And next up, we've got you. So you were the only, is it true, you were the only person ever to have introduced both this man, the King, Elvis Presley, and these guys, the
yes.
Beatles?
As a matter of fact, I did an interview with BBC last week in London, and I didn't know this, but I'm the only living guy that ever emceed Elvis and the Beatles. I couldn't believe it, but I guess it's true. It's just, you know, both of them. And this is an interesting shot here. This is, I know you can't see it on that screen, but it's in color. It was taken at Empire. This is Empire Stadium. I'll tell you a very quick story. This is 7 years after Elvis was here. It was the same pandemonium. Same. Anyway, it got out of hand, and everybody was pushing forward. And Brian Epstein, their manager, was at the corner where I was. I just brought them on. I'm standing down there with the inspector of the police force, Bud Arrington. And Epstein says, you've got to get up and stop the show and tell everybody to back off or the Beatles are leaving. And I said, you don't interrupt the show. He said, listen, have you been to a British football game? And I said, no. He said, people get smothered, they get crushed. I'm not going to have that happen with my boys on stage. So I said, okay, I'll go up. I waited to the end of a song, and I'm walking out, and John Lennon, I mean, the crowd noise, ladies and gentlemen, I don't know if anybody in the audience was there. You couldn't hear yourself think. So I hear this voice out of my left ear saying, get the F off our stage. It's John Lennon. So I look over and I walk over to John and I say, listen, Brian Epstein down there sent me up here. And he looked at me and he said, carry on, mate. I'll never forget that. And my son, Jeff, said to me later, Dad, no matter what you accomplish in life, you'll always be remembered as the guy John Lennon told to F off the stage.
And we don't have quite a clip of that, but that incident.
No, I do, but I'm not playing it.
Okay. You actually have a recording?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
But here's a little bit of the Beatles press conference.
Thank you. We'd like to...
I hate to... look, we've got to back some of the people up. There's been two kids crushed already. They'll have to cancel the show. Hold it. Down. Everybody down. Or no show. The Beatles want to perform for you, but they can't do it. If you don't sit down now, let's sit down. They want to perform for you. Come on.
So, almost like a preschool teacher.
We'd like to ask you if you'd help us with this next song. Hello.
Paul.
We'd like to ask you if you'll join in. Will you join in with this next one? Will ya? Okay. All right, listen, it's dead easy. All you got to do is clap your hands or stamp your feet, something like that, or sing, do anything you like. The song's called Can't Buy Me Love. Can't buy me love.
So it's surreal. It's surreal to hear your voice next to these legends, these people. You mentioned, you know, you hear people talk about their experiences on stage with bands and hobnobbing with who's in what's, and then, oh yeah, you know, this guy was there. And so I turn over to Brian Epstein, of all people in the world. It's just, it's unbelievable that you've had these experiences, and that's you.
I know. You know, within me and with my family. I still can't believe I've gone on this journey. It's been unbelievable from a kid from Vancouver. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, it has been.
Could be you.
What's that?
It could be you. Kid from Vancouver. Anything more to say about the Beatles, Red?
What's that?
Anything more to say about the Beatles?
Just that they were four really different characters. I thought they were fascinating. I loved their music. But this was the early stage. It got more interesting later after Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band and The Revolver and all those different albums. They were just incredible. And you know what? I really believe, like Cole Porter, George Gershwin, sorry, this music will live on for a long, long time, no doubt. Here is Mr. Buddy Holly. I don't know if any of you ever saw the musical Buddy, but the kid that played him here was a local boy from Vancouver Island called Zach Stevenson, did a great job. But Buddy Holly was a star for 18 months only. He and I got together when he came through Vancouver in 1957. It was called The Show of Stars. And for $3, you got to see Chuck Berry, Fats Domino, Buddy Holly, Buddy Knox, the Everly Brothers, Laverne Baker, and on and on. And I said to Buddy Knox years later, what was that like? He said, well, Red, we'd get out and we'd do two songs that we'd had out. And if there was enough applause, we'd do the third. You know, Eddie Cochran was on that show, too. That was amazing. And they traveled in a bus.
They probably never played only two songs.
It was amazing. Truly amazing. But here's something interesting. When I played this for John Lennon, because this was 57 and Lennon was here in 64, I had a little reel-to-reel tape. And because he's a big Buddy Holly fan, all the Beatles were. As a matter of fact, Paul McCartney bought the songbook, everything Buddy wrote. And why did you like him so much? And he said, well, not only is music ready, he said, when he appeared in England on the Saturday night, is it Saturday or Sunday night at the Palladium? Saturday night at the Palladium. He came walking out with a Stratocaster. We had never seen that kind of a guitar in England. I said, why? He said, in those days, you could only buy guitars made in England. So I said, how did you guys end up getting guitars? You and Jerry and the Pacemakers and everybody else. He said, we pay off merchant marines to bring them over from the States. Amazing. But Buddy had a prediction that when I played this for John Lennon, he couldn't believe it. Because, you know, we take and make legends out of people. And in some cases, it's deserved. In Buddy Holly's case, it is. But he wasn't a visionary. And when I asked him this question, he had an interesting answer. Listen to this.
Well, right now, I'm going to put you on the spot. And I said I asked you before, and I didn't have a microphone with me, but I'm going to put you on the spot again. What do you think about rock and roll music? Do you think it is on the wane or what?
I think it's going out quite a bit in the States.
Down south?
Uh-huh.
How far down?
Deep.
It is, but I mean, how long do you think it will last? Another 6 months, 7 months?
Oh, possibly, yeah.
I think after Christmas, things may change a bit, though.
They might pick back up, but I rather doubt it.
A lot of faith you had in the craft there.
There's Buddy Holly. Well, we all thought it wasn't going to last. We were all kids, and we thought it was like a hula hoop. You know, be gone tomorrow, but it wasn't. You know, still around.
Well, and Bobby Ferris, who is speaking with us on the air today on CIVL, he's with CHWK, the Hawk 89.5 in Chilliwack, and he was saying, "Well, Buddy Holly, he was a pop songwriter. That's what his love was. It wasn't necessarily the rock and roll persona or the rock and roll kind of attitude that was coming out at the time from the Perkinses and the Elvises. He wanted to write songs, and maybe fortuitous or beneficial for him if rock and roll were on the way out."
But the reason he said that was rock and roll was changing. They had Paola investigations, right? And Elvis was going to go into the army. Chuck Berry was arrested on the Mann Act for bringing an underage girl across the border. Jerry Lee Lewis married his 14-year-old daughter. And rock and roll was on the skids, you know. And then it became, you know, vanilla rock and roll, if you wish, with Frankie Avalon and people like that. Not knocking them, but rock and roll was really going through trouble. That's why he said that, I know. Here's another good friend, ladies and gentlemen. It sounds like name dropping, but I think you recognize here that it's just the position I've been in. But for 23 years, this man here, Roy Orbison, was a friend. And I ended up in his will, which is another story. And why that? I'll tell you that quickly. He had put me in there because he said, if anyone's to do my life story, get a hold of Red Robinson in Vancouver. He has more interviews on me than anyone alive. And I did. A great guy and never really moved on stage. He would stand there and sing. But I've got to remember the story I told you today for this group here tonight. When Roy first came here, first time he ever came out of the United States was to Vancouver. And he played the Exhibition Gardens. And he was backstage pacing up and down, and my a partner in my concert business, Les Vogt, said, Roy, you look pale-faced and nervous, and are you all right? Are you going to be able to go out and play? He said, oh, yeah. He said, I'll do a little Roy. He said, you know, I've been laughed at a lot, and people
look at me and think I'm a homely man, which I am. He said, and I've been booed at, too. But he said, you know what? I'll go out there, and after the first song, I'll own them.
The confidence of a talented and effective
exactly.
performer.
Exactly. And all the great performers I've worked with, they get nervous before they go on.
Is it any different for a broadcaster than it is for a musician?
No. Stages are funny things because you can have a calling in life, but how many callings do you face rejection every time you step on here? You know, it's amazing. But anyway, here is a little clip from Roy.
Did you make records, Roy, prior to going into the Sun Studios with Sam Phillips? Or?
Yes, I did, Red. We the first thing I did, which it's not generally known, I had this group in West Texas, and we went to Dallas, Texas in December of 55, and recorded Ooby Dooby. It was supposed to be for Columbia.
Yeah.
And then I remember it real well because I had my first car wreck going home. I tore up my dad's new Oldsmobile. And so the next thing we heard was this fellow, Papa Hollifield, we call him. He was a local record store owner. He said, you know, Ooby Dooby's coming out by a group called Sid King and the Five Strings on Columbia. So what they'd done is get us to make a demo. So I ran over to Norman Petty's and recorded Ooby Dooby again with Trying to Get to You on the Other Side. And then Pop Hollifield sent that to Sam Phillips. And Sam heard it, and he said, can you be here in 3 days? So we went to Memphis. I recorded Ooby Dooby again, but this time I was going to do Trying to Get to You, and he said, we can't record that because Elvis recorded that. I sold it all to RCA and promised we wouldn't re-record it, so I had to write a song called Go, Go, Go that became Down the Line on the other side of it. So that was my first recording, but in Dallas, and then in Clovis, New Mexico, and then Memphis.
An amazing guy. How many of you here ever saw Roy in concert? Did you? Amazing performer. Amazing. Quick story about Roy. The last time that we saw him, a bunch of us went backstage at the Orpheum. He'd performed there. And he'd been in town for 3 or 4 days. And I said, Roy, how come he didn't call? We go to dinner or whatever. He said, Red, I was here. I've redone Crying with K.D. Lang. I said, really? He said, yeah. I said, where did you do it? And he said, there was a Jaguar dealership near that. I said, oh, it was Blue Wave Recordings on 2nd Avenue. So anytime you hear Crying with K.D. Lang, it was recorded right here. Yeah, amazing guy.
That clip from Roy Orbison, similar to the, I believe it was Little Richard, was a latter year clip. These are we're looking now 30, almost 40 years in between the start of your career and the end of your career. Do you have when you're later on in your career, you've got yourself on solid footing? Do you come at an interview from a different perspective? Do you have a certain authority later on in life that you didn't have as a youngster?
I think so. I think it's called maturity. And it's called experience, you know, if that's what you mean. I when I greet artists at the theater all the time, and I see a lot of old friends come through there. We've got Chris Christopherson coming up and other people like that. And, you're more casual with it. I mean, you got to imagine, like, the Show of Stars with Buddy Holly and Eddie Cochran and all them. I would go out and introduce them, then I'd go backstage and do a quick interview, run out on stage, back and, you know. It was amazing times, but I took a photographer with me. These shots are great because I'd hire a photographer, and people say you had a sense of history, but it's like I said before. No, I was a fan then and now, and I wanted to preserve it, and I'm glad I did. A couple of interesting short stories for you, talking about a trip, my journey, and thank you all for bearing with me here. But here I am in Portland, Oregon, a 21-year-old kid. And I went down there to get television experience because it was a radio and television combo, which was unusual for a Canadian to see that. Anyway, while I'm there, I see these guys in the coffee shop. And I said to Don Porter, the program director, who are these men? He said, well, one of them's a senator from Massachusetts who's running in the Oregon primary. His name's John F. Kennedy. And that's his brother, Bobby. And that's a writer there called Ted Sorensen. I said, oh, really? Because I didn't know anything about American politics. But anyway, they were there for 3 days, and you can read about it in a book called The Making of the President, 1960. But it was a thrill there. But being a rock and roll disc jockey, I'm in the studio in the afternoon, and I've got the monitor blasting out, you know, Peggy Sue or something. And I can see the senator on the other side of the glass, and he's in facing towards the studio on the other side, and he's doing spots for commercial announcements for the Red Cross or the Oregon Cancer Society. And I'm still blasting away, and I could hear what he was doing because he had a little button. You can do it and hear what's going on in the studio. Next thing, I'm going sitting there in my own little world, and I look out of the corner of my eye, and the door opens, and there's the senator standing there. He said, "Red, I like rock and roll as much as the next guy, but I can't hear myself think."
Did you have a
These
comeback?
Are memories, I'll tell you.
Did you have
and
anything
I apologized. I said, "I'm sorry, you know." It's all right.
Well, because it was your fault, the rock and roll, Red. You brought it.
Yeah. Anyway, a couple of things, thrills in the career. From the lawn of Graceland, doing interviews there for NBC and global television here by satellite. That was amazing. The opening of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Carol and I said, in our lifetime, we'll never see anything. None of us in this room will. 80,000 people, and every act you can think of came out there. They do two numbers and disappear. Started at 7 o'clock at night, ended at 3 in the morning. So you're standing there, and there's Aretha Franklin doing Respect. She steps off. Bruce Springsteen comes out. He sings. Then there's Jerry Lee Lewis. Then there's, you know, the band with Robbie Robertson. And there's Bob Dylan. And they had all these Johnny on the spots around. And I said to Carol, I'm going to get up and go to the, oh, my God, it's Creedence Clearwater. I can't go. And this is how it carried on till 3 o'clock in the morning. You couldn't afford to have all these people there. But Carol, being the most observant one in our family, she said, but look, we were, I guess, about 12 rows back from the, and we could see the side of the stage. And it was a rotating stage, by the way. And all these bleachers. What was happening was Bruce Springsteen would finish, he'd get up and watch Chuck Berry. It was amazing.
The mutual respect.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they would be clapping for each other and supporting each other. I mean, what a thrill to be there, to be part of it. It was amazing.
Is that maybe indicative of the entertainment industry not being a competitive kind of fishbowl for everybody to be in?
I think so. I don't think it's there's no. It's like politics, you know. You think they hate each other? They don't. They don't. They're all in the same game. And by the way, I don't care what political stripe you are. Adrian Dix spoke last Saturday night at the Radio Television News Directors Association Awards night, and Carol and I were guests, and he got up to speak. I'm not a political animal, and I thought, well, what's he really like? He told a story about we're not getting the right people to run for politics, and he said why. I mean, you're under an X-ray. I mean, you know, he gave the story. He said, everybody's, you know, knocking Gordon Campbell and all that. He said, listen, anybody that'll step up to the plate, you're not going to agree with everything they do, but they did it and you didn't. Your neighbor didn't. And I thought Adrian had a point. We want good people. We want good government. Let's not put them under such a microscope. Everything they do is wrong? Come on.
That's a brave statement for the leader of the NDP to say about.
No, I think he's a calming factor. He's looking at it differently. And I'm with him. I'm a child of the media, and I'm ashamed of it sometimes. Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
The way they attack everybody? Yeah. The Expo 86 was a great experience. 41 of the greatest rock and roll acts of the time. The CAB award that I got, Lifetime Achievement Award, the Hall of Fame, presented by Lloyd Robertson, that was amazing. And Johnny Esau, who passed away. Did you see that in the paper? He was a great sports guy. We all got it the same night. And just a couple of quick things, talking about experiences, and I don't want to neglect them. One is Dean Regan wrote a play about my early life in rock and roll, this stuff, called Red Rock Diner.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a phone call the other day, and it's coming back to the Valley and to Vancouver next June. So I'm delighted with that.
That's in 2014 or in 2013?
Pardon?
2013, 2014?
2014.
So next year, we can watch out for it.
And I just wanted to say to Mark and you and everyone else here that one of the great honors I ever received was from the University of the Fraser Valley when they gave me an honorary doctorate. I never expected anything like that. And I said to Mark, I try to pass this on to my kids too. My Irish grandfather was a street philosopher. And when things were starting to happen in my career in the early days, he said to me in his Irish brogue, he says, I want you to remember something, son. Honor seeks the man doesn't seek the honor. And I live by that. I never went out to win anything. And all of these people, who knew that I'd meet them all? I'd like you all to do me one favor. A friend of mine is here tonight that made sure all of these photographs and clips were put together for me. He's a dear friend, Phil McAsee, over here. Phil, thank you. Thank you for that. Thank you.
Now, Rhett, I wanted to ask you one more question I know you wanted to address. You mentioned about how you had kept all of your recordings, and you've got all this archive of what you've done and what you've accomplished in these interviews you've had throughout your career, and you've given them to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame for preservation. And, of course, in the United States, they have the Smithsonian Museum for the preservation of recording arts and other methods of art. But in Canada here, what we don't have is something you've astutely pointed out, and you mentioned Lloyd Robertson earlier. I believe he's, along with you, very concerned about the fact that nationally we do not have right now a national archive of music where we can...
Or broadcast, neither.
Okay.
And what's interesting about that, Aaron, is that, and I'm going after the politicians on this one in Ottawa, mm-hmm. we're the only country in the industrialized world without a broadcast museum and without a music museum. Like, we've not had a history? So I called upon people that I've known or people that I know who know them. The Lloyd Robertson I know, of course. Knowlton Nash, remember Knowlton, ran CBC. And we're all going after everybody. We need a museum of our history.
So is this the kind of thing people can write their MLA, their politician? Is that something you'd advocate for?
Yeah, I think so.
It's good enough from Red Robinson.
5, 6, I'm trying to think how many years. It's my 5 or 6 years we've been working on this. And they don't get it. I don't understand. Is there something embarrassing about what we did?
Is it too expensive? Is there too much of it?
Well, how much all the commercials cost for the War of 1812? I don't need any more of that.
Your heritage. Well, this is. It's part of our heritage, and it's part of who we are as Canadians, and it's a contribution that we've really made throughout from coast to coast, from Halifax to Vancouver. That's
exactly.
The great music we've had.
And look at the musical history. You know, it's funny. When I started out on radio, there weren't many Canadian artists on the charts. And we talked about this today. The reason was that we've always had talent. I mean, one of the little groups out of here is going on to great fame now is called Headley. But you see, there's studios, and then the electronics improve. We didn't have people that knew how to produce records. So even the early Anne Murray, Gordon Lightfoot, and these are good friends, they recorded in Chicago or in Nashville. Anne did most of hers in Nashville. Justin Bieber of his day, Bobby Curtola, he went to Nashville, fortune teller and all those things. So what the radio broadcast rules for Canadian content, which I don't think they need today, we've got the talent. It's come that far. And I have a personal thing against the government programming my radio station. Let the public do it. So it's been, but you try and get rid of a bureaucracy, it's over. We're going to have stars anyway. And currently, look at the Bieber and the young lady out of here, the Jepsen
Carly
girl.
Jepsen,
amazing.
Yeah.
But we've always had the talent, but we didn't have the way to get it out there. And now we're on the world stage. People like Bruce Allen, who, you know, fought for acts like Bachman Turner Overdrive, you know, and currently, of course, Michael Bublé, and before that, Bryan Adams. These are people not just in this province, worldwide. You know, you can't believe when Bryan goes to perform in London, even today, he sells out 2 or 3 shows in Wembley Stadium. I mean, it's unbelievable. So, yeah, I just think they could dump that out. And, you know, it's too bureaucratic. And just let all the talent rise, because we've got the facilities to do it now.
You know, 2 years ago, the CRTC even tried to increase Canadian content standards, and definitely, certainly from the campus community radio industry, we were not in favor of that.
But who are the pinheads doing it?
Oh, they're members of the broadcast community.
No, they're not.
They're members of the telecommunications bureaucracy in the administration.
Yeah, there you go.
They're not elected officials, that's for sure.
No, and I'll tell you where the bureaucracy goes crazy. I had the program director at CIL a couple years ago say, Red, would you make a phone call to this guy, Jeff? I said, sure. Where is he? CRTC, Ottawa. I said, okay. He said he doesn't believe that the song Meadowlands with the Chessmen, or Which Way You Going, Billy, with the Poppy Family, there's two or three, were Canadian content. And so I phoned this pinhead, and I said, Jeff, how are you? He said, who is this? And I told him. And I said, you're questioning. Let's take Meadowlands or Mustang, which was an instrumental with the Chessmen, produced by Terry Jacks. And I said, that's not considered Canadian content? Not on my list. I said, well, I was there in the studio, and my name is on the label. It was produced here. As a matter of fact, Jeff, when I got you on your line, would you send me a copy of your citizenship papers?
Oh.
I mean, it gets that stupid, okay? We've all been in a lineup at the post office, and you just get up to the front counter, and they put closed, right? Mm-hmm. Same thing.
Mm-hmm. So, Red, maybe there are members of the audience who'd like to ask a couple questions.
Anybody got any questions? Yeah.
Himself. So we've got microphones on in the aisles over here. And
Mike there?
Anybody who's got a hand you want to put up, just walk it right up to the microphone.
There you
and
go.
And if there's
a moment, I thought we were that boring. Please.
Hi, Red.
Hi.
Nice to see you again. You won't remember me, but over the years, we bumped into each other. Class of 61, King Ed. I just want to tell you, when I was one of those screaming, giggly 14-year-old girls, you brought so many fond memories for me and my friends to remember. We used to go down and watch you at the radio station. We're like 13, 14 years old, through the glass. Oh, it's Red, it's Red. And we were in your fan club. And I was also there to see Elvis in 57. And we snuck around to where you were interviewing him. And the door would swing open once in a while. And I was so short, I remember some guy beside me picked me up. And I went, oh, there he is with the teddy bear. So you've brought so many wonderful memories for us. And it's a pleasure to see you again.
Nice to see you. What did you say your first name was?
Well, it's Roz, Rosalind.
Thank you so much. You know, it's funny that you... Thank you. I got to know Dick Clark for years, and we were, you know, reasonably good friends. And he said to me one time, you know, what's the greatest experience, Red, in your life? I said, what are you talking about, Dick? He said, I'll tell you, you probably share this with me. When someone says, thank you for being a part of my life. Thank you.
So thanks, Red, for sharing with us parts of your life put on by the University of the Fraser Valley and the President's Lecture Series. We've talked about how you got involved, what your opportunities were, and how you've made good on the opportunities you've been given. What would you say to young people today who are interested in following their passion through entertainment, through broadcast? What kind of, I mean, we've talked about follow your dream. Make sure that you're committed to what you're doing. But what are some of those other intangibles that are really important?
Well, I don't care whether you go into radio, anything, rocket science, whatever. You got to have a passion within yourself. If you don't, it's not going to work out for you. Everybody that I've ever met, and not just entertainers, successful people, they had a dream, they had a vision, and they let no one say you can't do it. You know, you must understand, and Mark, the president of the university, and I were talking today, and, you know, it doesn't matter who says don't. If it's your dream, it's your dream. You got to live with it. You got to live with yourself. But I feel lucky, and I've met a few people that have the same look at life, and that is, aren't you lucky if you get up every day and you can't wait to go to work? because it was never work for me, ever. Yes, I put myself in a situation where I'd put things together, take a lot of hours, but it was never work. It was never work. No.
The reward is the accomplishment that you really care about.
I always had ideas. I thought, ideas, I'm going to come up with ideas, you know? And I did. Lots of things like Rock and Roll at Expo, the Legends of Rock and Roll. These kind of things I'd come up with. And so the ideas always live on. You know what I'm saying? As far as I'm concerned, soon they'll be singing, Glory, Glory. Never mind. You know one thing about getting old, huh? It doesn't last long.
And neither has this conversation, I suppose, in the
future. Any other questions, Mr. President?
No, I'm going to encourage a few others to come up here
and ask
a question. And while I'm waiting for you, here they come.
Great.
Terrific.
Red, I was intrigued by one of your comments about the early days of disc jockeying and rock and roll. We hear a lot about the great innovation of the internet and the advantage of the producer and the consumer being able to interact more closely than they ever did. But you pointed out that one of the great innovations of your early career was this seeking out from the listener what it is they wanted to hear.
That's right. That's right. And you know what revolutionized radio in those days? Please understand, the movies were dead, radio was dead, the disc jockey came along with a thing called rock and roll, but it was a youth explosion. The first, you know, if you look historically, the word teenager was never used before rock and roll. That's the truth. And you go, what? Yeah. But, Mr. President, looking back at all of that, the greatest single moment was when the transistor radio came along. It revolutionized everything. Because if you go down to Kitts Beach or someplace and you took a portable with you, you better have worked out in the gym before you lifted it. It was 65 pounds because the portable battery weighed so much. So that was the greatest breakthrough. And the rocket radio that you used to listen to in Hamilton, Ontario, right? Questions, yes.
Over here.
Okay, just a point of information maybe. Dick Clark's American Bandstand in Reno, Nevada. How do you consider your theater here in comparison to Dick Clark's at American Bandstand in Reno?
I've never been to that one. I've been to American Bandstand Theater in Branson, Missouri. And so I know what you're talking about. They're similar. Paul Revere and the Raiders and Bill Medley were playing there when we went down with a group of people to what I call the Music City Tour and did Nashville, Memphis, and Branson. The difference was Dick Clark had a showcase of cars in the theater in Branson, and I thought that was a good addition. As far as the theater goes, I think ours is comparable in more ways than one. They really went out of their way for the sight or for the sound and the lights in the theater named after me. They did a great job. And there's 1,000 seats, which is, I think, about 100 more than the Clark Theater.
If my memory serves me correctly, from the American Bandstand in Reno, they also do nightly dancing there as well on the weekends. The only reason I can remember this is that I've been there a few times, not through my age or anything, but not that I'm numerically challenged as some of you other folks are. It's just a number, by the way.
That's right.
I've traveled there doing what I do as a job, so I'm aware that there are certain things that are a little bit different, and to bring forward our Canadian content would be far more interesting in your facility as putting it somewhere in the East where a majority of us won't have an opportunity to go see it.
Yeah.
And I think it would be, or it would serve your theater extremely well in that respect. And people would probably get a better idea of where all of this really originates from.
Well, thank you. Thanks. For that. Yeah. We had Gordon Lightfoot there a couple weeks ago. And we almost lost him a couple years ago. It was very, very close. And I didn't realize, he told me, they put him in a coma for like, you know, months. So his body would repair itself, and he's there playing. But he looks frail, but his voice is still there. It's amazing. Good Canadian. Anyway, go ahead.
Oh,
The gentleman mentioned Dick Clark. That was an exciting thing for us when we went to CBOT station in Burnaby, I guess, to the American Bandstand in the 1960, 61. But what I was going to tell you is we were at the alternate school, John Oliver.
Ah.
And our big thing at John Oliver was the Harlem Globetrotters came, Jack Kyle came, and our good friend, Red Robinson, we knew you as Diane and Janice's cousin. And that was a big thing to us. We said, you really know him? Yeah, he's our cousin. And they were quite shy about it, but we were so excited because we saw you through the radio, through our transistors. And that was around the time of Itsy Teeny Weeny Polka Dot Bikini, and that was, we had to turn it down when my dad came in the room. And we had to listen to you under our pillows.
That's
so
right.
The transistors were great. Thank
but
you
weren't
so
they,
much.
But weren't they wonderful times?
They were wonderful times.
And we had more social times. I worry about the kids today, they don't socialize. I saw a bunch of them the other day sitting at a table in a restaurant. Every one of them was texting. Nobody was saying hello.
That's exactly it. I told two fellas the other day to talk. They kept getting their phones ringing in the restaurant. I said, why don't you phone each other and talk? Because they are actually getting texts from other people.
I know.
And there's no conversation.
Because
our day, when you were talking on the radio, and you were so young and so wonderful, and I want to ask a question, personal question. You don't smoke anymore, do you?
What's that?
You don't smoke anymore, do you, sir?
No, I did in those days, but then everybody did.
Yeah.
Remember Mad Men, the movie, or the television series? People say to me, young people say, was it really like that, smoking and drinking? Are you kidding? Of course it was.
They don't even represent it enough, do they?
Well, we remember you asking one of our classmates for, you knew she smoked, and you asked her for a light. And so that was kind of an exciting thing, too. We all talked about it at lunch hour.
You helped me smoke?
I'm glad to hear your voice is still there and that you certainly aren't smoking. Thanks a lot.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else got a question about any of these performers or any others? Because I've been around most of them. Anyone got a... Yes, sir. Thank you for doing this. I know it's hard to get up and ask a question in a theater, but I'm really interested in what you have to say. Go ahead.
Hey, Red, I'm a mission fella. I always remember riding the bus home and being able to... I can't remember a radio station. I think it was... which radio station you were on when you first started. Which one was it?
CJOR. It doesn't exist anymore.
Well, that was probably the only one we could get out here. Anyway, what I'm wondering about, because you were just a young punk kid, were you very intimidated when you started doing interviews with some of those entertainers?
Were you intimidated when you started doing interviews with entertainers like you know, Buddy Holly, Bobby Darin?
What made it easier for me was near John Oliver High School, that lady went to J.O. and not jail, J.O. But I phoned the principal there one day. At one time, John Oliver was the largest high school in Canada. 4,100 kids went to J.O. And in 1957. And I would phone up the principal to ask him if he'd do a PA announcement for the fact that I was going to be over at the Sunset Community Center with a singer called Guy Mitchell and tell the kids to come on over. And so because I was on stage with people like that in those early days, it was 55 or 6, but it made it easier for me to get out and perform and talk to people on the stage. The other thing is, sir, and it's not a matter of bragging, but I guess it could be interpreted that way, but you either like people or you don't. And you know what I believe? I watch television, I go to shows. You can tell if somebody's sincere or not. And I've always been in love with what I do. And I like people. That's the difference, to answer the question.
And it shows. Thanks, Red.
Thank you.
Sure does.